So, sorry for the delay. This is going to be a small introduction to performance biomass management. So first I'm going to do a quick talk about the basis of performance, what we can do with small introduction, and then to actually use performance. Who am I? Ewout Paul Menkaert is my name. You can forget it right now. I'm on GitHub like most of you. Currently on sabbatical, so I won't bore you with my employer and how great it is. I'm part of the performance core team, which mostly is my top modules, and also the maintainer of the performance power in this plugin. So you might notice that paramount management isn't really the normal subject I work in, but it's an introduction talk, so hopefully we'll be alright, and I can point you to the right people who know everything. About performance realm, what does it do? It focuses on installation, configuration management, and updates and drift management of systems. Or in other words, like the product itself, that requires provisioning, configuration, and monitoring. So you can provision to almost everything, bare metal, many virtualization providers. If it's not supported today, it can be supported through a plugin. I know there's one for Xen, Open Nebula, and you name it, it can be supported. But we focus on bare metal today, so not really the point of interest now. So, how can we do provisioning? We can do Pixie based, so that will be the most interesting part for today. You can do it through Pixie Linux with Kickstart, Pre-seed, AutoYast. It's all template based, so you're very flexible in what you can and can do. We have some community repository where you store all templates, so you can also submit your own. We have some contributions for Juniper switches, Cisco equipment. You name it, you can pretty much, if it does Pixie, you can provision with it. There's also image-based deployments. Those are mostly for the cloud or visualization providers. But I know Lucas is working on doing image-based deployments on bare metal as well. He's doing a talk, which I'll refer to later. Also, in virtualization, we created the VM for you. And besides that, we do some orchestration through smart proxies. So you can create your DNS records, your DSP, TFTP, if you do FreeIPA, configuration management, and for DNS, in the default we support IRC Bind, Microsoft Active Directory, and libvirt. There are plugins as well for that. So PowerDNS, I know there's one for Infoblox, Amazon Cloud 53, for DSP, there's our default IRC, DSPD, and Microsoft Active Directory. There's also a plugin for Infoblox again. So it's very flexible, and you can pretty much make it work for your environment. Configuration. I won't dive into deep now, because it's not about configuration, it's about bare metal. But it's important to know it's there, it's well integrated, and have a look at it if you want to. Monitoring. So there's a generic API for graphs and trends. You can do some system inventory. You get reports from your configuration management. Personally, I think it's a bit lacking, but it's growing. One big part is the auditing. Every change is logged, so you can audit all everything, who changed what, when. And I think many enterprises really like the feature. There are plugins as well to improve it. So there's a custom-made bug report tool, which can report back and forward. OpenSCAP for your policy compliance, the plugin for CNET2, so your host exists. But again, personally, I think this is still an area where you're not that strong and you can still grow a lot. This is my personal opinion. I think one of the core strengths of the form is flexibility. It has the same defaults, but there are lots of configuration options you can change and make it work in your environment. You can mix and match components you want to use. So, does your company forbid use of DHCP. Some companies do, and don't use it, use the other forms you do like. I think that's the core strength. Again, I mentioned the templating before. Many things are templated. You can change what you want. Again, same defaults which work for most people. It's easy to get going, but lots of room to grow your whatever your organization does. Plugins, might have mentioned it before, it's one of the core ways we can expand the foreman. Plugins are released outside of the normal release cycle, so gives you a bit more flexibility. That also has a downside that some plugins might have lower quality, but many of them are very high quality plugins. There's context sensitive search. It works very intuitively because there's a keyword completion, works across the application, generally a very good point of the forum. Short bit about the history. Started in 2009, so quite a mature project by now. Initially focused on Puppet and Pixie provisioning. As you can see, we grew a lot. We have quite a few new contributors. I think every release there's about 90 different contributors for a single release, so it's quite a stable core group. And the core team itself is sponsored by Red Hat. That's because the foreman is the upstream for Satellite 6, along with the Catalog plugin. But the foreman started outside Red Hat and only moved into a bit more Red Hat project itself later on. Translations, the community is great, lots of friendly people, very helpful, that's why I stuck around as well. So a bit about the architecture. I mentioned Smart Proxy before, they do most of the heavy lifting. They talk to your DHCP server or your DNS servers, so foreman doesn't have to be inside your every network, and it's just a central server. And distributes the actual workload to the proxies. There are support for organizations and locations. This is optional, and you have to use it, but it's there. There's also a strong role-based access control system to separate access. Personally, I can't use it because I do work in small organizations where it wasn't used. But for authentication, you can also use LDAP and directory, so it integrates nicely into your organization. Pixie provides a lot more. You have the foreman itself in the core, and it will talk to database. We support SQLite, but that's not pretty public production. MySQL and Postgres. Postgres is the default we use. For the authentication, there's directory I mentioned before, or LDAP. Different smart proxies, they can be segregated networks. So, the foreman only needs to talk to a smart proxy, and the proxy itself can live in an entire different data center with different networks. Each proxy can have different features. Mentioned DNS, DHCP, TFTP, Puppet. There's different options. And talk to compute resources. Technology itself. The foreman is Ruby on Rails application. It started on Unix platforms. And Smart Proxy is written in Ruby and uses the Sinatra framework to provide REST APIs to the foreman. It runs on all Ruby 2.0 and newer platforms, so it includes Windows, though it may not be here, relevant here. For the installation, the repository is for CentOS, Fedora, Debian, Ubuntu, but it is known to work on FreeBSD, Arch Linux, and maybe some other platforms. We have a Puppet-based installer, so we bundle all the Puppet modules, have a small wrapper around it, and that gives all the options Puppet modules provide. Action is involved. There's a lot of options, maybe too much. We try to separate it in No, and advanced parameters, but maybe if you have comments about it, please do tell. Again, the same defaults. It's easy to get going, and we'll manage your application. Again, since just Puppet modules, nothing special. You can also use the same modules to manage your deployment in production. For the more common ones, for Apache, Postgres, MySQL, we use the Puppet Labs modules. So we didn't reinvent the wheel there. And for a couple of things, we have our own modules. They're all Forge as well. I can highly recommend them. Maybe you'd be biased. So, short recap. It focuses on the system lifecycle, provisioning, configuration, monitoring. Again, you can mix and match, use what you want to use, don't use what you don't want to use. It's flexible in that way, discrete architecture, and we have an installer that makes deploying new installations very easy. This was a short recap, or a short introduction. I don't know if you have any questions right now, otherwise I'll move on to using Forkland. So, using Forkland, it's all about your environment. No environment is the same, and you want to use Forkland the way you work now. And prefer not to change your workflows. In my experience, that's a very reasonable goal. There are many settings. You can change settings from the UI, configuration files. It's very native to how SysOps works, how you, every other application is managed. So it has a look and feel that you use. Besides that, there's automation with the API and command interface, and I'll talk a bit about some interesting plugins. The API is a RESTful API, and there's full coverage of the UI. Anything that you can do in the UI, not in the API, is a bug. So if you run into problems, do tell us. There's a documentation DSL inside it that describes the API, and from that we can generate Ruby bindings. There's also an unofficial bindings in Python, which you can use. And again, the documentation provides. So every server has the API doc available, and it's also on the website. There's a command line interface for it. Again, if you use the API, it should be on par with the UI. Anything you can do in the UI, not with the command line. Consider the bug and file report. If you use a Puppet application, you can store it for ease, so it's scripted. There's output in a table format, which is human readable, but also CSV, YAML, JSON, so integration into other tools is also easy. As you can see, it's quite easy to use. Say, just this load search, this is all the search syntax it uses. So, again, we search here for the domain is example.com, and we get all those within that domain. Or if you want to reboot host.example.com, and it's easy as that. You can also pass by ID, so that's why the name parameters there. It's a powerful tool and very useful. Some plugins. This is a screenshot from the website. This is not the entire list. The entire list is on the wiki, and these are the more interesting ones. A few I want to point you at that are interesting, but I won't dive into deep. I think the setup one is useful. It helps you configure your initial Forkland installation. So besides the installer, then you need to configure a bit more for your picture provisioning, which domains do you have, which operating systems do you have, associated templates. Setup makes it a bit easier. Templates one as well. I mentioned we have a community repository where all the templates live. You can import them from there, or any Git repository, so if you have your own set of templates, and you prefer Git to store them, you can import and use the templates plugin. Remote solution is also an interesting one. You can run, I think, it's just an SJS, and you have some templates to run the jobs. And the cockpit one is also interesting because cockpit, I think it's a very interesting project, and have a lot of options there. Do check it out. But I want to look now at the discovery plugin. This is the your Pixie provisioning on steroids. It uses a default boot for your Pixie environment. So any unknown node will boot an image, then it becomes available as a discovered host inside the format, and from there you can provision it with like any other host. As a default image, you can provide your own image if you want to. And the default image is based on CentOS 7, so you get all the hardware support that CentOS 7 has. It's extensible and simple, so if you want to update your BIOS or firmware or do your hardware rate configuration, you name it, you can add it. So that's very powerful. In essence, you can do metal as a service. Have a pool of hardware, have a set of unconfigured hosts, and provide a service to other departments or if you're in a cloud setup to customers. You can provision those monthly, so you can provide rules. Say CPU counts is lower than 8, then it's a web server, and otherwise a database server. Any fact, and fact is what factor provides. You can also provide custom facts in your image. So very flexible again. And I had to show a demo, but I need to. So this is a short overview. On the left we have the foreman, on the right we have the first VM. So you go to the discovered hosts. As you can see, there are no discovered hosts yet. I edited a bit to remove loading times. So just boot up the VM, we'll show the Pixie menu. Then it will do netboot, boot up your image, and usually it doesn't take that long, but then it will show a menu, and you can either manually do some tweaking, or by default it will have a timeout of 10 seconds where it will just go. Then it will report itself to the foreman, and you can see you have your discovered host. And so discovered host. There's some details about it. General architecture, different things like how much memory, how much disk space, what kind of hardware is in there, CPUs, all these things, network interfaces. It's all based on what Vector can provide. And you can, again, as I said, you can provide your own custom facts in your environment, maybe rack location through some other source, or that's a gadget. From there on, you can provision it. And I'm going to open the next video. So you can install it. I'll skip the wizard now. Just quick provision. As you can see, right, it's still booted. And from there on, it will just reboot itself and then do the next Pixie run and do your kickstart. So, again, it's very powerful. And this can also be automated, so it's very easy to use. I think it's well documented as well. So powerful stuff there. There's also the Pixelus version of it. This an ISO. You can just use install some. Maybe mount it through your ILO or whatever system you use if your environment doesn't allow Pixie or DSP. From there on, it will record itself in a similar way as a Pixie boot, but manually. So we also have another plugin which does something similar. It's a bit older plugin. This this also provides an ISO, but it's based on iPixie, and not all hardware support. The hardware support is limited, so this will provide a bit nicer UI, but hardware support is limited. The other one is CentOS 7 image, so all hardware that supports CentOS 7 will work there, and this is a bit limited. I would recommend check out Discovery first, try to get it working, and don't focus too much on boot disk, but that's my personal opinion. So that's hardware stuff. I also know that some the Hooks plugin is also a very powerful one. Here you can hook into anything the Foreman does. Creation, deletion, updates for every object there is, it will call the hook. It can be written in anything. It's just an executable. So it's Shell, Python, Ruby. It's a directory style, so run part style execution of all the hooks. So that's very flexible. I know people do some very interesting things with it. I know one of my consultants set it up that they will, on host creation, they will contact the ILO of the host, mount it, the ISO, and move from there. So if it doesn't work by default, you can be very great here. And on a short example, so simple bash script, we've got two command line parameters, which kind of event, and a small string representation of the object. You can also receive JSON objects through send in. You can use tools like jgrab or command line to get information from the JSON data. And then be creative. This is just a short example. And actually, what matters. So if you hook failed, I think it does some rollback sometimes. Again, well documented, very flexible. There are some examples in the repository. Be creative. But that may be too little. If you want to change even more in the Foreman, you can use plugins. If you want different buttons in the UI or entirely new pages, new functionality, write a plugin. You can write with a Rails engine, just the extension part of Rails itself, with a small layer on top of the plugin registration, like checks. You can say, I want at least the format 1.14 because there's some feature in it. You get one of the about page with plugins are installed. So that's mostly just Rails development, and any Rails developer should be very easy there, very comfortable. The dispute is gems. Again, you can still package a gem as an LPM or that. And there's a template for repository available, so you can just clone it and get going. There's a how-to available. It's not rocket science. You can also write smart plugin plugins. There are Sinatra apps, so they can provide a REST API, entry points, do anything. There's a small registration layer for which plugins are installed, but that's all lightweight. Again, this is as gems, which can be packaged. And I think it's interesting to point out, some plugins allow to write just a provider. So DNS, you don't need to specify the whole API again, just provide a provider, which does host, record creation, record deletion, and we're making it even smaller, so you can write in just a few lines of code your DNS provider or DHCP provider. So what's next? If it was a website, if you do anything cool, let us know. We always love to hear stories of how Foreman can be used. We're on IRC, with a more general channel for users, questions, and there's a lot more focus on development. So if you're writing a plugin, that may be more appropriate. Again, across my mailing list. And there's also some other events. I think most, if not all, of you will attend FOSDEM. There will be a booth there, with also a working Foreman setup, with provisioning with some parametal hosts, so you can see this, everything in action. Play with it yourself. I think I recommend it. We're also at conflict management. One talk I want to highlight is the talk by Lucas from OS Images on bare metal, where it does image-based provisioning on bare metal. So even faster deployments. So very interesting. And after that, we have a formal discussion day where we will hack on different items. So that was my introduction to formal bare metal. Any questions?